mic is on. Thank you. I'm Johan Gulliksen, born 1936. At 1948, at the age of 12, I decided that I will sail in Olympic Games. Which was a very good ambition for a young man at the age. I hadn't sailed very much. My father bought me a sailboat, a Longen Axeter, 10 square meters from southern Sweden. And he started sailing with that. My father was a sailor, a big sailor, in the 6 meters class. But that was the young man's beginning in the yacht race. Of course, that sailing a little dinghy like that doesn't really do Olympic Games. But what was fortunate was that in 1952, in the Helsinki Olympic Games, the 5x5 meter class was first introduced and was the first time participating in Olympic Games. The 5x5 meter class was a boat class that was smaller than the 6 and 8 and so forth, and not following the same rating rule. But it became an Olympic class to replace the 6 meter. Our father died in 1954, and my mother, or our mother, felt so badly for the young men in the family, so she bought us an old 5x5. What about this
one?
L12. One of the 5x5s that were built for the Helsinki Olympics, 1954. It was an interesting boat. It was designed by Gösta Tynsell. It was made by the Wilenius brothers in Porvo. Out of material that was left over. The 10 boats that they had built before, all for the 1952 Olympics. So the boardings were short, all the material was very crappy and something that was left over. But it was a beautiful boat, which we sailed with quite a lot through the late 50s. And that brought the idea of aiming for Olympic Games. And you heard the star story here just a while ago, where you have to qualify, you have to do this, they have to do this. In those days, in the early 60s, there was really no other qualification, said that the Finnish Yacht Racing Union said that you can go to the Olympic Games if you succeed in this and this and this and this and these international races. And that's it. So, in 1963, we were told that the club, Nynäs Jatkuva, had bought a new 5x5, Ray Hunt design, one of the first Ray Hunt design 5x5s that was after the Rome Olympics became Ray Hunt, became the 5x5 meter designer because he invented or developed the 5x5 meter to a very short field, a very sort of concentrated body of hull in the middle of the boat. And that was very fast, in particular, in light. And everybody should have Ray Hunt. Ray's good friend, Josef Nemes, in Valtor, built his boat, Kaje, that was he named it after his wife, also 5x5. The maximum weight, maximum sailor, heaviest thing you can go make, and was extremely good in light air, which is a little contradictory, but it has to do with the reduced depth surface and so forth. Ray Hunt himself won the Worlds in 5x5 meter sailing the year before, and our club, NEK, decided that we could they buy the boat from Vato, and then they asked me to put on the crew to sail the boat, and with the aim to get to the 1964 Enoshima Japan Games. It was a very, for a young man, it was a fantastic situation. They gave me a boat, they said, you know, buy the sails, pick your crew, you need to qualify here and here and here, and then go to Japan. That's what I said. So, I chose my good friend Peter Fatzer as a tactician on board, and my also good friend and old good sailing friend Jussi Salovaara, who is sitting here, as a forex man, and we started qualifying. This qualifying races were not very advanced in a way that they were not organized in a way, but they were races in low venues that were very full of traditions and so forth, and there were a lot of famous yachtsmen among them. One of our goals was to beat Louis Lovera, who was the world champion of that time, a Frenchman that was a really good sailor, and we said, if we beat him, we can go to the Olympics, and so we did that in Cannes, or where it was in Genoa. I don't recall anymore, but anyway, gradually we worked our way through these qualification races, and ultimately they sent over. There's an interesting thing with this Japanese and the boat transportation of these were all wooden boats. We had no means to transport them other than by ship, in open cargo house or on deck on ships. And a boat that is built for maximum weight has to go through the tropics and up to the Japan. It was not a very nice deal, so when we came to Enoshima and the boat was weighed, it was 50 kilos overweight. What do you do? Start to lighten the boat, but we didn't want to touch the keel. Of course, so we started unscrewing fittings and taking out the boards and interiors. And finally got the boat in class and in weight and so forth. Why it was so particular? We know all that have been sailing yachts that you can have measurements and measurement rules, but you can't see where the water line is. You can't see the marks in an open boat. But the Japanese had made it very smartly. They had made a basin of plexiglass with high walls, plexiglass walls on the sides, so you can see the marks, you know, by eyesight, like this, in tanks. So we had to be really particular with the sizing. I'll come back to the construction of the boat and how we do it, like very, very, very later. But anyway, this was the races. Mr. McNamara from United States, he wrote an article a few years later after the races. He came from the gold, for the gold, and this is part of his article. And let's look at some pictures. Let's go further down. Here's the 5.5, very typical 5.5 of the 1960s. Who were the dominating designers at the time? They were Trey Hunt, Luders, they were those, and of course Len Olsson in Sweden. So there are only three boat designers, separate boat designers in Tokyo. But it looks like a very traditional, classical boat. It had a wide open cockpit. The 5.5 is a very wet boat, so we had to have hand pumps to bail them out. You didn't use bailers at the time at all. And in heavy weather, it was really one man's job to keep the boat out of water, out of the boat. And no hiking. We thought that we sailed with big spinnakers in heavy air. Here we see the spinnakers. I'll show you a picture of from last week in Curaçao. It shows a similar situation, heavy weather, down in sailing. We can look read here, there's very famous names, Bobby Simonette, Bill Nolton that won the goal at the time, Robbie Nature from England, Agostino Straulino from Italy, one of the famous tugboat sailors, United US 50 Bingo with McNamara and so forth. Finn Sarald of Norway in Fram. It's very interesting from the point of view that the whole series was won by the boat called Baron Joy, by Norton, a fellow who had never sailed a 5.5 before he qualified for the Australian. It's quite interesting. It happened last week. Again, the same phenomena. A person or a team that are professional dragon sailors from Germany came into the class, bought a boat, a good boat, and sailed it a little bit, and came in to sail the World Championships and won it over the whole fleet in a very elegant way. So this is not only for those that are in, it's a question of good sailors and good sailors. Okay, let's look at some other pictures here. Interesting is Enoshima Bay, the Japanese coast waters are very deep, so you can put on marks very easily, so we sail very close to the coast, which is a high coast. This is the only reason why we have to be able to put in the rounding marks in the water. Let's go further a little bit more. Here, here is a typical 505 L24 Cayenne is visible there. You can see that they have little saggy sails, Dacron sails. People are not. It doesn't look very racy at all. It looks very, very sort of pleasant. Okay, let's go further. And this is a heavy air upwind race. Nobody's liking. Everyone is sitting inside the boat, looking around like penguins out of when I was first introduced to the 505 in the class, and we were sailing the 505 in Helsinki at the age around 20, we were told not to hike. In these boats, you are not hiking. You are not laughing and shadowing down me. Because gentlemen open their lunch. So we were the bad boys. Hiking the boats, we started doing a lot of bad things, coloring downwind banks and so forth. Coloring during upwind. This was not done. But this is the way it looks like. And they are very classic, beautiful boats, as no question. I'll show you a moment about the problem. Continue. There is Mr. Norton and his crew, the very typical 1960s boat. These particular 5.5s are sailing still today. The race is in the classic category of 5.5, but they are still racing. The problem is that those that were the hardcore racing boats of the 1960s are far too slow to compete with the modern 5.5s because of changes and modifications of the rule and development of design of boats in general. So let's go further again. Let's a little bit further, I think. Yes, let's go to the test result. Here is Mr. Norton, who was drinking whiskey in the bar after every race, very heavily, and then sailed very well during the day. Okay, let's continue again. Here we can read here, there are lots of famous people here named here, and I won't go into that detail, but here's the result list from the Olympic Games in Enoshima Bay in the 5.5 class. Won by Mr. Northam, second was Mr. Lasse Dörn, and
And then Mr. the American wrote the article, and then Salvino and so forth. We were number six, which we were very proud of being in this particular field. There were famous boats like Fram 3, the Grand Prix of Norway at that time. John B. Bobby Simonetta was behind us. Johan from Britain were behind us. Berg from Denmark, and so forth. So this was an experience, nice experience.
Well, Sanders.
Yeah. Yes. So that kept us going. We came home, and then with Peter, we started saying that what shall we do next? I said, I've been in the Olympic Games, I had a goal to get to Olympic Games, I've been in the Olympic Games, it's over for me, track racing, we'll sail offshore and do that sort of thing, but this crazy thing is not going to continue. Because it's hard work to qualify, to race X number of races under hard conditions in hard competition. And although the 5.5 meter boat wasn't that physical to sail at those days, today it really is, because of the changes of design. So let's go back a little bit. Let's move
upwards.
No. Let's forget this whole fight.
Take the slide.
One after the other. Remember how the downwind looked 1964 and how it looks 2013 in January, last week, outside Curaçao, the resort in Curaçao, in very heavy wind. Spinnakers are much bigger. We are not using reduced size spinnaker for heavy weather downwind, because the bigger the sails are in heavy wind, the longer the surface are, the faster is the boat going downwind, and it doesn't matter. You cannot, there's no idea to reduce sail there. You just go and hope that you stay alive and in the right direction. This is part of the field. We are here at 349. Okay, next. And going up in three-man crew is hiking, all of them very heavily. Boats are sails, masts of carbon, of course, sails of carbon, and the whole rigging is very, very advanced. We are not only changing the sail plan by playing with the rigging, we are also changing the shape of the boat. The boat, the modern 5.5, is constructed so that it's very stiff in the axial direction, can take a lot of load, and that stiffness is of course important to keep the force straight all the time, but it also makes the boat go better in the waves. But it's in the transversal direction, it's very flexible. So if I pull, this is not me, but it's Jochen Schumann, the famous Olympic sailor who sails in the class. There are many professionals in front nowadays. The backstay, running backstay comes in on the side. When we pull that hard, it hits the whole hull quite considerably and put in a longer water line on the And we built that boat, the boat I sail now in Curaçao, and have been sailing since 2007, is constructed that way. Otherwise, it's similar to my previous one. And I still don't know today whether this is faster or not. But anyway, that's the way they look like. So it's a completely different boat as you compare to what happened in the 60s. So let's move over to this other project. This is a slideshow that I made to some of my friends when we built the so-called Hadam 2. Okay, here. Since I'm an engineer by profession, I like to talk about numbers and design. And I have also, I must admit, that I have made the mistake of designing 5.5s in my lifetime together with 80. Still, they were fairly good boats, but not on the top notch. So, so in 2003, I decided to ask for professional help. Sebastian Schmidt, who designed the boat. But this is the design diagram for the 5.5 meter. Here we have the sail area, minimum 26.5, maximum 29 square meters. Displacement 1.7 to 2.0 cubic meters. And this is the equation up there that we have to fulfill. And if you stay within this square, the boat is a 5.5. What happens is that all boats are designed in this upper corner, as close as possible to the upper corner. Why? You get maximum sail area, that's fine. You get maximum displacement, that's bad. But you get long water line, that's fine. So all of the boats, the boat that we sailed, Reihan boat that we sailed in Enoshima Bay, was right here, where the boat that we built 2003 is in the diagram. It's interesting, but that's the way it is. So that hasn't changed in at all. The rule is still the same, the measurement rule is still the same, and there is no deviation. But people are still trying to build boat here in this corner. There are every year, or every second year, there is someone said, hey, we should make a light boat that planes bail downwind and so forth, and he builds a boat here, and they fail. It's like the 6-meter rule, the 8-meter rule, and many other rule boats. You come up into this corner, big displacement, long water lines, much safer, and the boats are faster. High risk and heavy going. It's interesting that when the American Cup boats went from 12 meters to this international ACC boat, they wondered what rule they should use. From where shall they take an example of a rule, of a boat that can be developed in an interesting way? And this is the EIC class boat. They looked at the 5.5 meter. They looked at the 5.5 meter because the 5.5 meter had developed over the years as a boat in a way much different from what the R class boats were developing. So it's basically almost the same formula. Of course, the limits are different. We are talking about 400 square meters of sail and 23 cubic meters of displacement, and waterline length is quite substantial. But the rule is the same, and what came out was that if you compare the boats, this is not the morning where I made the comparison for me. Here is a Lindy, which won the America's Cup 1 year, and there is a modern 5.5. From the same time. It's quite interesting when these people that started designing these boats, they started using the 5.5 as an experimental boat for their design ideas. Regardless of the fact that the America's Cup boat has much deeper draft. And uses a bull gear while the 5.5 doesn't do that, and so forth. But the boats end up looking the same. Very small rudders, very small keels, with trim tabs to get the lateral force because the keel is too small to give the lateral force that we need. So we have to use trim tabs and have a sail under the hull itself also. So this is, so we started, to build a boat like this, and here it is in the builder's yard. You can see that it doesn't look like a classic yacht at all. This is on Lake Thun in Birkes shipyard. Wing keel, twin towers to compensate and give a small lateral force going up in. Hydraulically operated. Very narrow, but deep rudder and very short keel. The keel is too small to accommodate the 1 ton of lead that we need to. It's too small for them. So we have taken, and there have been people trying to make a big bulk down here to get the tons down, because we know traditional distance tells us that the boat sails better the more the point of gravity lower down it is, and that's the way it should be. These people that played with the IAACC class, and also those that then came over to the 5.5 meter class, realized that this is not the case. It's a lift. The keel is not big enough for all the lead, so we should have the lead spread over the length of the boat. One type boats like the Star, another, it really doesn't matter because they have all the same sort of bad properties. But a short boat like the 5.5, which is only slightly more than 7 and close to 8 meters in waterline length, all hull lengths around close to 10 meters, if you put too much weight down here, the boat starts pitching in base and very heavy. This says that we don't have the same stabilizing power. We have to, by manpower, keep the boat straight by hiking. So everyone on board should be heavy and strong. In order to save weight, we have eliminated all winches. Winches are slow in fast race boat sailing. Too slow, so we are, everything is operated by hand. Here is from the inauguration of the boat, myself, the postman of the island of Åland, Mr. Lundberg, a tactician, and Mr. Timo Telkola from Turku, who is our sailmaker, the North representative of England. And the boat builders, of course. This is the way the boat looks. This is not the last boat we have, but it's the newer boat is the same. The hull construction and design of the hull itself, in terms of construction, the lines are the same. It's slightly longer, but it's single skin. This is sandwich construction. Sailing on the Lake Thun. At that time, we didn't have seamless 3DL sails at all. They weren't ready for the small boats like the 5.5. So they were three-dimensional sails, but made by panels with lots of carbon fiber in them. The 5.5 is a beautiful boat, not only in heavy weather, but also in very light air. This is from Bernadette on the Normandy coast of France. This is us, who, as an outcome of this race, who we lost to this plan here, Norway 57, we lost the World Championship 2003 and came second. This is a great start. This year, this was 1 year, 2003, we sailed a lot of races, and I won't go through all these details, but this is a very difficult, how elderly gentlemen who try to sail effectively and internationally and successfully, what 1 year season of racing contains. Started off in May with Dutch Open Championships. We won that. Scandinavian Gold Cup, of course, have only one boat per nation, so there were a few. Swiss Open Championship, 42 boats. French Open Championships 2003 in the venue of the World Championship and in the World Championships. Quite a number of starts in order to be able to stay all with it. As an amateur team, and that means that that 50-60 race starts per year is not abnormal. And when you are 77 years almost old, you start feeling it in your bones. So that was it, and. What I would like to say furthermore is that why did we start sailing 5.5 meters again? After 64 we decided this is it, stop. But then a sponsor here in Finland, Jaakko Pöyry, had a boat built that was designed by Hans Grupp. It's a 5.5 designed by Hans Grupp and put a young team of sailors, Tompa Jelosaki Harima and Markus Manston, to say it, and they won the Gold Cup. We have been sailing for the Scandinavian Gold Cup with Peter Patzer and Jussi Salo many times. I lost every single time. He came sometimes to the finals and sailed the final sails, which are match racing events that we have always lost. And these two young boys, three young men, said won the Gold Cup. Peter, we were sailing the Gotland Round. Nice night. Sun was setting, spinnakers up, slowly going. Peter stopped. Did you notice that these boys won the Gold Cup and went second in the world? And I said, yes. He said that, shouldn't we do something about it? I said, no. But during that shift, Peter said, we can at least talk about it. So we were talking, we talked about it. And when the shift was over, we decided that now let's show that. So we, the next year, that was 1985, the next year we asked Hans Grupp to design a 5.5 to us, which would be a get better, of course, than Helena, of course. And so we did. And we started sailing that, and we won the rock. And of course, that it's like an old, I can imagine, old alcohol addict. After 20 years, takes his first drink, and I'm on the downstream. It was really bad, but that was the way it was. So, how many 5.5s have I seen in my own sort of? Start with Pohjantähti, that was Korvatippan 2. Then we sailed Ingalin 44 in the Helsinki Jubilee Regatta 1961. May lost to Folkeva Sea and the Gold Cup 2-3. Then we sailed Kaje. Then we sailed Treguba, Adam Cube, Adam Quattro, so the 8 5.5s.
Right.
Kandu. And Kandu in between, yes. Or it Matti that remembered us, yes. So that was 9 5.5s. All of different designs, all in that right upside corner of the diagram, and all sailing and behaving very differently, but all very enjoyable boats. So if you want to sail long, become a sailing agent, you don't need to win here all the time. We haven't won many times. We have 2 worlds. 2 gold silver medals, we have 2-3 bronze medals and a few gold cups. Between the gold cups, we won the gold cup last year. 26 years. You have to stay on and stay on and stay on and try to clean it up and get it back to the last helicopter. So we have to know how to be beaten and not be depressed from that. And then sometimes also blind hen, hey, hen finds something. Thank you.
Thank you.